afternoon. Thank you all for coming this afternoon. It's our good fortune to have Professor Pantsov to come here to talk about his books on Mao and Deng Xiaoping, two very important studies. Of course, I know Professor Pantsov the book, but I do not know him in person very well. Actually, this,
we met in Taiwan.
Yeah, this is the second time we met. The last time we met in Taiwan. But we have several mutual friends and working in this area. So I did some research in the internet, trying to find out what Professor Pantsov is up to or about. So here is the highlight I got from the internet. Professor Alexander Sasha Pantsov is a girlhood professor of history and humanity in Capital University, Columbus, Ohio. Originally, he's from Russia, from Moscow province. His birthplace is Yegorevsk.
Yeah,
I checked that place, very close to Moscow,
it's
about 71 miles southeast of Moscow. And Sasha earned two doctoral degrees, one from Academy of Sciences of the USSR, and the second from the Russian Academy of Sciences. And Sasha is also a master of five languages, Russian, English, Chinese, French, Japanese. And he lectured extensively in China, Russia, in US and UK, and he's a regular contributor and interviewee in Chinese, Russian, and Western news media. So he's a very good figure, even to news media. And Sasha published, edited, authored more than a dozen books, and published more than 100 articles in seven languages. I'll talk those languages, but so many. Of course, so far his most important books are Mao, The Real Story, and Deng Xiaoping, A Revolutionary Life. Both are the first studies of the subjects based on Soviet archives. This is a very important feature of these two studies. The book on Mao has already been translated into several languages. Most interestingly, two Chinese editions were published just this year. In April, Taiwan published the first Chinese edition, and in August, the People's University of the People's University. The Chinese People's University in China published the second Chinese edition. We just talked about the differences between the two editions because censorship values and different things resulted in different versions. So I would not be surprised if Sasha will very soon publish a book on Zhou Enlai, or maybe on Liu Shaoqi, or and other top leaders of the Chinese Communist Party.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to extend my deep appreciation to Professor Liu Xiaoyan, for inviting me over. I am very happy to be here because for me it's like going back to my youth. In 1991, I was here at this school lecturing. At that time, I came to the United States to do my research in Woodrow Wilson Center. Washington, D.C. And my good friend, who at that time was professor here at your university, Woodford McClellan, who was professor of Russian history, he invited me over. And I still remember it was a lovely day in November, so I lectured here on Russia and China and the perestroika at that time. You know, it was the most important subject. So thank you again for inviting me. I'm very glad. So Professor Liu asked me to talk about my most recent books about Mao Zedong and Deng Xiaoping, and to I spent already 25 years working in the Russian archives. I first came to the Russian archives in 1990. I'll speak about it. So, my major books, my major publication are based on archives, on my research, not only in Russia. Okay, of course, the Russian archives are probably the most important because it's been kept in secret for decades, and just right after the Yeltsin Revolution in August 1991, they were open to the public, and many scholars began to research the Russian documents and the documents of the Communist International, the international organization that the Bolsheviks set up in March 1919 to promote worldwide revolution. But I also used some other depositories, and one of the most important was the depository on Taiwan. This is Diao Chazu, it's a Bureau of Investigation. It's kind of like Taiwanese KGB. It was also a very interesting experience for me. And of course, many archives in the United States. But still, the most important is this building. This is the Russian State Archives of Social and Political History. It used to be the Central Party Archives during the Soviet times. So the archives of the Institute of Marxism Leninism at the Central Committee of the Russian of the Soviet Communist Party. These archives began to be organized by the Bolsheviks shortly after the October Revolution in 1917. The Bolsheviks began to collect documents on Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels, on other leaders of the World Socialist Movement, and then more and more documents would go to the archives. And right now the archives is divided into two parts. The huge section of documents on the Soviet Communist Party and the Soviet Communist Party activity, and the second huge section is the section on the Comintern, Communist International. So actually the Soviet Communist Party dominated the international organization because the Russians had money. And the Russians financed the worldwide communist movement, and since they controlled the resources, they actually controlled the whole organization. And all the sections of the Comintern, including the Chinese section, the Comintern people even call the Chinese Communist Party our Chinese section. The Comintern was based on strict discipline. They had their own international leadership called the Executive Committee of the Comintern, dominated by the Russians. It was an international organization, but dominated by the Russians. So, needless to say that when I was a student, Moscow State University, Institute of Asian and African Studies, that I graduated from in 1978, of course I knew about these archives, but I had never had any access to these archives. I began to work in the Academy of Science. Professor Liu said that I got two PhDs. It's just we have a very strange system in the Soviet Union. You see, in order to be considered Doctor of Sciences, we have to get two PhDs. The first is candidate, the second is PhD, real. So it's not my, fault, or it's not my, that's why. It's not like, I got my first PhD from the Soviet archives and the second from the Russian. It's the same academy, they just changed the name. But, so I got my first PhD in 1983, then I published my first book in 1985. On the ideological struggle within the Chinese Communist Movement. And then I continued to work on my doctorate, we call it. So then I got my second PhD in 1993, in 10 years. So, but I never had any access to the archives. Because as I said before, the archives had been kept secret to the general public. And even members of the Communist Party not Poland, just maybe a tiny minority of bureaucrats, they had access to these archives. But then Gorbachev came to power, Michael Gorbachev came to power, and the situation began to change. In 1990, a year before the Yeltsin Revolution, when the Communist Party was still in power, at that time I worked in the Russian Institute of Comparative Political Science in Russia, Russian Academy of Science. I sent my application to get an access to the archives. I've been denied many times, but this time I got an access. Because everything was in chaos already, you see, and Gorbachev did not control the situation. So I got an access to the archives, and I still remember I came to the archives and came to the head of the Comintern department, the section of the Comintern. And I said, look, so I got an approval, so could you please show me documents on the Chinese Communist Party? I know you have a special section on the Chinese Communist Party. They said, we don't have anything. I said, how come? That was a woman, 100% Stalinist. Later I learned that she was 100% Stalinist. And she looked at me and said, you know that in the 1950s, during the period of friendship between the Soviet Union and China, we gave all the documents to the Chinese. We don't have anything. We even don't have copies. I said, it's very strange because you know that I know some books published by some Russian Sinologists. They work in the Central Committee of the Communist Party. They published some books about China, and they quoted from books published in the 1970s, so they quoted from the archives. Then she looked at me and said, she didn't blush, nothing, no change. She said, yeah, we do have it, but I will not give it to you. I said, okay. So then I said, how about, I know you have a personal file of Stalin, who was the leader, and of course Stalin was a man who controlled China's policy also. She said, okay, we'll check. And she gave me this folder, like this. I said, that's all? Stalin never published anything else? That was the same with Bukharin and Trotsky, so they didn't give me anything. But I still go to the archives because I meet good people there. At that time I met good people of my age, a little bit older. They were clerks. They were not members of the leadership or the administration. They were just clerks. And we chatted, we drank tea, and just chatted, you see. And they talked a lot about the archives. So we became good friends. And then, 1991, August, Yeltsin came to power, everything changed, the Great Revolution, down with communism, great moment in our life. And in September, I got a call from one of my friends from the archives, and he said, Sasha, I am now a deputy director of the archives. Come here, I'll give you everything. So I was incredibly happy. Everything changed, you see. The old director resigned, a new man arrived. He was from the Academy of Science, he was a historian. And when the guy came to the archives, he said, we will publish everything, no secret of communism. So the situation resembled 1917. Trotsky came to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and said, no secret. We will publish all the documents of the Imperial Russia. I was very lucky because at the time when I got to the archives, we had no law on the archives. There was no special law that would regulate, the archives. So nobody knew what they could give to the reader or not. So I remember I came to a friend of mine. He introduced me to the director and said he's a good friend. So okay, and the director said, "What can I do for you?" I said, "First, I need an access to the Chinese files, okay, the file of the Chinese Communist Party. And then I want to read Stalin, Bukharin, Trotsky, Zinoviev." And I said, "I know, and I knew it from my friends, that you have a special section in the archives that nobody, even top bureaucrats, communist bureaucrats, never had any access. This is a special collection of private dossier, private files of foreign communists." I mean, during the Soviet time, when any foreigner, crossed the border of Russia, immediately the KGB and the Comintern would start collecting data, some sensitive stuff, medical documents, some information by KGB and stuff like this. This is special section. And among personal files, there is a huge collection of Chinese revolutionaries. Not only members of the Communist Party, but also members of the Kuomintang, the Nationalist Party. So, actually, what we have in that is we have altogether about 2 million written documents, lots of photographs, movie tapes, and preserved in almost 700, 669 collections. The Chinese section is probably the most interesting. So there is a file of the Chinese Communist Party delegation to the Executive Committee of the Comintern. There are stenographic records of various meetings between the Chinese and Soviet representatives. There are information collected by the Soviet spies in China. And actually, what I learned from these documents that even in the Central Committee of the Chinese Communist Party, there were some people who provided secret information to Stalin about Mao Zedong, about many other members of the top party leadership. Not all of them were Russian, some of them were Chinese. And information from Russian physicians attached to Mao Zedong. Mao had Russian physicians. And many, many, many other documents, including documents on wives and kids, children of the party leaders, and so on and so on. The collection I'm talking about, this most secret collection, comprises 3,328 personal dossiers. It's a very impressive collection, and when I asked the director, "How about, can I get an access to these archives, this file?" He looked at me and said, "Why not?" And signed my application. I took this application, came to the head of the Comintern department, the same woman. The situation changed, but we still had the same middle rank staff. So I gave this document, she looked at the signature of the director, said, "I will not give it to you." I said, "But the director signed it." She said, "But he's stupid. He's a newcomer, and tomorrow everything will change." You know, she was a prophet, actually, everything changed. So, but I came to the director again. I said, "I'm sorry." She was about to call this woman. He was very angry. I said, no, don't do it. Just write again. Please give it to him. So anyway, it needed lots of patience, you see. So you have to go there every day and talk to people and stuff like this. So anyway, I received everything because I established YNC. So you can get everything in Russia, in China, if you have one connections. When I teach Chinese history in my school, I start my lectures by saying, look, first of all, you should memorize these two characters, Guanxi. If you get it, you will get everything in China. So the same in Russia. So thanks to my relationship, connections, you know, to the archivists, to the scholars, so finally they began to give me everything, and I still enjoy this privileged access to the archives. Anytime, you know, I go to Russia twice a year, actually. I spend the whole summer in Russia and Christmas in Russia, and all the time I go to the archives, and all the time they give me something else. And it's very interesting. So, anyway, when I came to these archives and began to work with the personal files, in addition to many other documents, among personal files, I found 15 volume personal dossier of Mao Zedong. 15 volume, huge, okay? So, frankly speaking, maybe one, two, three scholars before me, they ever checked it in the 60s, in the 70s, but they all belong to the party elite, and at that time they had no time, they had no rights to publish. You see, they just could quote a little bit. That's it. But the situation changed. I had my camera. I began to copy. Everything was okay. So, and they helped me to Xerox copy and stuff like this. So I made lots of copies. I found 10 volumes of Joy and Life file, I found a 2-volume Deng Xiaoping file, and a 4-volume of Lin Biao file, and many, many, many other. Okay, just name it. I found Chiang Kai-shek file, I found Zhang Zinguo file, and numerous documents. So, in addition, among other things, I found dispatches from Russian diplomats and Russian spies, very interesting. There is another interesting collection, the Stalin file, okay, collections, thousands of documents. The code name is 558, the Stalin collection. And when I worked with Stalin documents, I found special group of many folders, like boxes. And these are intelligence service documents sent to Stalin, you see. So I found it's very interesting. Stalin actually read everything. You can see he'd read pencil. He always used red pencil while reading documents. Made some exclamation marks, underquotes, and stuff like this. And among other things, I found intercepted letters and information from the Soviet spies in China. And for example, I found information in these files that Sun Yat-sen's widow, Sun Xingling, worked for the Comintern and provided information. And she had her code name, Madam Susie, and she worked with the Soviet spies in Shanghai, and she was involved in the financial transactions. And then Moscow sent money to her account, and she took money and gave to the Chinese communist, whose name was Pan Hanyan. And Pan Hanyan would give documents to, money to Mao Zedong, and so on and so on. I also discovered that the Mexican consul to Shanghai, who was Mauricio Fresco, was recruited by KGB and provided information, many, many other things. So from these documents. And there are lots of manuscript memoirs of reminiscences, recollections of many communists preserved in the archives. I also used them. So, the first book I published based on the archives, it was not my first book ever published, but that was the first book based on the archives. That was the book I managed to publish, not in Russia, first, but in the United States, England and the United States. It's titled The Bolsheviks and the Chinese Revolution. It's basically based on the Russian archives that cover the history of the first United Front in China and the relationship between Stalin and Sun Yat-sen and Chiang Kai-shek. This book, The Bolsheviks and the Chinese Revolution, would later, I would translate it back into Russian and would publish in Russia next year. But first it was, it came out in England and the United States. Then, this book on the Bolsheviks and the Chinese Revolution came out, and in a few years, I received a call from a famous publishing house in Moscow called Molodaya Gvardiya. In English, it would be the Young Guard. So, that's a very famous publishing house. The publishing house is famous for the series of biographies. They began to publish these biographies in the middle of the 19th century. And many people just collect these books, biographies. And I received a call from an editor who said that he read my book about the Bolsheviks and the Chinese Revolution in Russian. And he made me an offer. He said, how about if you write a biography of Mao Zedong? And I was excited. First of all, because by then I already collected lots of documents and I already had an access to Mao Zedong unknown files, and I could use them. And second, I became very happy because, as a matter of fact, my grandfather, whose name was George Ehrenburg, he was the first biographer of Mao Zedong. I mean, he published a short biographical sketch of Mao Zedong in 1934, 3 years before Edgar Snow. He published it in Russian in a journal, and this publication, as I know now already, was the first publication that actually launched the cult of Mao Zedong in the Soviet Union. Before that, the Russians had always published articles, not about Mao, but about Mao and Judea together. Mao Zhu. Never about Mao. And there was the first article about Mao as the leader of the Chinese Communist Party, 1934 in November. So, and when I got this offer, I said, my God, look, my father, my grandfather started, and it looks like that I continue what he started to do, so it's a great opportunity for me. And anyway, to write a book about Mao for a sinologist, it's like to play a role of Hamlet for an actor, you see. It's a great gift. So, thanks God, in a few months I got on sabbatical, so I had the whole year to write the book. And so I wrote this book, and they published this book in 2007. This is the book, that's how it looks like, this is the Russian edition. And they couldn't publish everything. I wrote 1,300 pages. It's a long manuscript, 1,300 pages. I gave this manuscript to the publisher. They said, my God, never, 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 it's impossible. So they asked me to cut it, so I cut it. And finally, this book is about 900 pages. So anyway, but I felt a little bit embarrassed, you know, because I like all offers, you know. I worry, oh, you know, that piece was so interesting, but they didn't publish it. Anyway, around this time, in 2007, a wonderful friend of mine, whose name is Professor Steven Levin. He's a very famous sinologist and our mutual friend, Professor Liu. And he visited me in my house in Westerville, Ohio, and I gave him this book as a gift. Stephen is fluent in Russian, also Chinese, Russian, you know, English. And Stephen looked at the context of the book and said, "Sasha, I will translate the book." I said, "Steve, it's a huge book, you know, I have no money to pay." He said, "I don't need money, I will do it, you know, because it looks like a very interesting book. And I'm going, in a few weeks I'm going to retire, so I will do it." I would have never done it because I had no time to do it, you see. And Stephen did it. I'm very grateful to him. And he translated again the whole manuscript, 1,300 pages, okay? And then we began to look for a publisher here in the United States. And we had a literary agent, and he did a great job. And finally, Simon & Schuster said, "Oh, we're going to publish it." And at the same time, a German publishing house, Fischer, said, "We also publish it in German." So we accepted both offers. And but both publishers said, "It's impossible, we cannot publish the whole thing, we need to cut it." And then we cut it. So we cut different parts, you see. So the English edition is not like Russian edition, you see. Stephen, when he was cutting, he said, "You see, this sounds too Russian. American readers will not get it." So, and stuff like this. So, and he believed that some parts about Jiang Zingo in the Soviet Union, we don't need it, we cut it. And some other parts, the whole history of the Chinese Trotsky movement, we cut it, and so on. So, anyway, the book came out in, I will get back to this. So, the book came out in America. This is Simon & Schuster, this is the book. So, then the Taiwanese approached my literary agent and said, we want to translate and publish the book in Taiwan. And they did it. So, this is the book published in Taiwan in April 2015. And the book to the left, this is the German edition of Mao Zedong. The American, German, and Taiwanese edition, they are identical. So they, both Germans and Taiwanese, they translated from the English edition. They didn't change any word. So, but still I had much more that I couldn't publish anywhere. So I accepted offers from some Russian publishers. And in addition to my Mao book, I published two volumes. It's titled, that's the first volume, the second volume in Russian, titled Stories About Mao Zedong. So here I included chapters that I did not include to the Russian book. Then I continued to do my research on Mao and published this book. This book is titled Mao Zedong Autobiography. I translated the chapter from Edgar Snow's book. Plus, in addition, I incorporated original documents from the Russian archives. So it's basically the documentary study of Mao Zedong. I had no place to incorporate them into any book published, you know, in Russia, like Mao Zedong biography, so I did it with this book. And then I also translated Mao Zedong's poetry. I found him a great poet, and I was really impressed with his poetry, and I translated all his poems, and it was the first edition in Russia, Mao Zedong poetry. So, Clouds in the Snow. That's the title, that's the phrase from the famous Mao Zedong poetry, Clouds in the Snow. So, then I published this book. This is a documentary collection. Karl Radek was one of the major ex expert, the Soviet Comintern expert on the Chinese Revolution. So I found his personal file and lots of documents that shed light on the struggle between the Stalinists and Trotskyists in the 1926-27 on the Chinese Revolution. These documents never been published, so I published them in Russian. And next year, this book is coming out in English with Brill publishing house in Holland. So they accepted the manuscript, so this book is coming out in English next year. So in the meantime, I continued to work on the archives, and I published kind of like a sequel to my Mao book. It's a book about these nice looking men. I'm kidding. Deng Xiaoping. Okay. So this is a biography of Deng Xiaoping, based not only on the Russian archives. I found, as I said, two personal volumes, many documents. I also found a personal dossier of his wives. Okay. He married three times, it's known. So his first wife, Zhang Siyuan, was a student in Moscow. The second wife, Wei Jingyin, was also a student in Moscow, and she was a patient in the psycho clinic, and she died in Moscow. So I found personal files of these women. I found personal files of his uncle, who was also was a student, and many friends of Deng Xiaoping in the Russian archives and incorporated these documents. Plus, I found dispatches from the Soviet ambassadors that shed light on the intra-party struggle in the Chinese Communist parties in the 50s and the 60s. I found stenographic records of the meetings between Deng Xiaoping and the Soviet Communist delegation. You know, that Deng Xiaoping was one of the leading figures that was behind the Sino-Soviet drift at the end of the 50s and on the 60s. He conducted these most sensitive negotiations that Mao Zedong valued and appreciated what he did, Deng Xiaoping. And many other documents, but also my Chinese friends. My friends in the People's Republic of China, they also helped me greatly with the documents, because the outsiders, they have, you know, we have no access to the Chinese Communist archives. But some Chinese, they use Guanxi, and they do have access to these archives, but I have Guanxi with these people, so they shared, you know, some documents and stuff like this, but I will not tell you their names. Okay? So, I also used these documents for this book, for Deng Xiaoping, and some other staff, members of his bodyguards and friends and family members and stuff like this. So that's how the book looks in Russian. Then, my Mao book, as Professor Liu already mentioned, was also published in the People's Republic of China. And before this lecture, Professor Liu also will talk about the differences between my Taiwanese edition and the People's Republic of China edition. And Professor Liu said that may be a good idea to mention this during my lecture. Actually, it's a very interesting story from my point of view. When I published my Russian book in 2007 in Moscow, shortly after that, I traveled to Beijing just to do my research. And our mutual friend, whose name is Shen Zhihua, and he, as far as I know, he's coming here on Monday. Unfortunately, I will miss him, but he's a good friend. And he has his friends also in the People's University in Beijing, so he introduced me to these people. Anyway, to make long thing shorter, they made me an offer to translate and publish my Mao book in Zhongguo Riming Daxue, People's University, China's People's University Press. It was before Stephen began to translate it into Russian, and You know what I'm talking about. So I said it's a good idea, why not? But I never believed that they would publish. Because the book about Mao that I wrote, I tried to be objective. I will speak a little bit later about major features of both books, Mao and Deng, what was the most important for me in this book. But I'm a historian, I'm not a politician. So a long time ago, I already understood that the task of a historian is to understand people who lived in the past, in history. They already died. They passed away. So our task not to simply blame or praise the people who lived before us. Our task to understand them. So because, you know, otherwise we can criticize and blame everybody. We can say that Plato, the great philosopher, was an idiot because he didn't know what the DVD is, you see. But, you know, this is ridiculous. We cannot look at history from our perspective, you see. They didn't know what would happen, you know, and later. So the most important for me to be objective, even when I study Stalin, I hate him, and I don't like Mao Zedong. I don't like Deng Xiaoping, but I try to be objective to understand what they did. They've never, you know, there are no saints, you see, there are no ideal person in history but Jesus Christ, you see. But all other people are mixtures, you see, black and white, you see what I mean. So to write a book about Mao, you don't like Mao and, you know, but if you write that Mao ate kids and children, you see, for breakfast, it's ridiculous. You see, he didn't do so. You see, he made lots of mistakes. He committed many crimes. But at the same time, I try to understand why so many Chinese still believe that Mao was great. You see, and still his body in the center of Beijing and mausoleum and will be there maybe forever. You see. So that's what I try to understand. I try to be objective, you see. But at the same time, of course, I wrote many negative things because from my point of view, this is true, you see. The same with Deng Xiaoping, you see. Deng Xiaoping himself said that he doesn't want to, he doesn't want anybody to publish his biography because he said that if you write a biography of somebody, you have to say not only about good things, but about bad things. And he said that I think that I am 50-50, you see, 50 good, 50 bad. You see, that's Deng Xiaoping evaluation. So, and I finished my Deng Xiaoping book by saying that, look, I hope that one day the Chinese at least would go to Deng Xiaoping self-evaluation, you see, and maybe later they would accept that Deng Xiaoping also committed many crimes, you see. But that was the most important for me. So when I got this offer from People's Republic of People's University, I think they would never publish it. But they said to me, be patient. It will take lots of time. It took them 3 years. Three translators from Shanghai Shifeng Dashi. It's a normal university in Shanghai. Three translators. They translated, okay, my book. I gave them, again, I'm going back to the original manuscript. I gave them 1,300 pages, the original manuscript, you see. That never been published in any languages. So I gave them this manuscript. Believe it or not, in 3 years, they sent me the whole manuscript translated into Chinese. I was impressed. But it was just the beginning of the story. Then the publisher said, don't be fast. It will take time, be patient. It took 2 more years to work with censors. So they sent the book to the censorship. Okay. So, and I believe, oh no, they will never allow the publication. And then, in March this year, I received a letter from the editor. They said, congratulations, we are very happy, we are going to publish the book in August. They approved it. I said to my wife, it's impossible. And I wrote to them and said, look, please, I'm absolutely sure that censors cut something. Okay. Send me the list of cuts and corrections. They didn't answer. Then I was busy at the end of the year and stuff like this, and I sent them again an email asking, please send me the list. And in May, they sent me the list of cuts and corrections. It was a little bit more than 100. They said, this is the censors, okay? We cannot argue, this is a law. So, okay, I said to myself, if they cut everything negative, I would say no, don't publish it. But I checked, and they said that's okay, because most of the cuts, they just terminology, like I wrote manjougo, they wrote wei manjougo. You see what I mean? So false manjougo instead of manjougo, something like this. This is nothing. Plus, they cut all the pages connected with Mao Zedong's sexual life. So from their point of view, as far as I understand, you know, Mao was not a man, and so, I don't know, he had four wives, official wives, many, many girlfriends, but I don't know. He had 10 kids, by the way, but how come? Nobody knows. So then I said, no, okay, you know, I knew that my Taiwanese book is coming with all these sexual stories, okay, and intriguing stuff, so I said, that's fine, okay, it's not important. I mean, it's important, it makes it interesting, yeah, lovely. But, I mean, the most important for me was, I wanted to publish this book in the People's Republic of China, even more than in Taiwan, because I want the Chinese people, whom I really love, and, you know, I love China, it's like my, I don't know, second or third homeland, you know, America, Russia, China, you see. And I love these people, I love China, I love its history, and I really want them to know the truth about Mao, you see. So the most important for me was to show that Mao was not saved, you see, was not just an excellent person, but the man who also committed many crimes. Okay, so that was important. Important for me to show that the Cultural Revolution was criminal stuff and how many people lost their lives during the Cultural Revolution. There is a special chapter on the Great Leap Forward and the famine, the terrible famine, so I give numbers, how many people according to this research, that research, and blah, blah, blah. I give the statistic according to each province, how many people lost their lives as a result of the famine, and so on. So it created the atmosphere, created the picture, you see, that it was not ideal, you see. And the land reform and many other things connected with the revolutionary movement, and plus connection with Stalin and how Stalin controlled the Chinese Communist Party and so on. That was the most important thing. And they didn't cut it. I said, that's wonderful. But I had some back idea. So I said, please, before you publish it, send me the proofs. They said, okay. In 2 weeks, I wrote to them, please send me the proofs. Then again, please send me the proofs. And then they did send me the proofs. August 6th. And a note that these are the proofs, and we are going to send the manuscript to the printing house August 14th. So they gave me 1 week. They probably believe that I will never read it. But I began to read, And I was shocked, because in addition to these cuts, the Shanghai, the censorship did, they did their own cuts, and they didn't tell me. So I said, my God, it's terrible, but it's 950 pages, you see what I mean? So I focus on the most sensitive parts, okay, like the Great Leap Forward, like you know what I'm talking about. He said, no, I cannot approve it. So I wrote to them, said, I'm sorry, but you violated the contract. They had no rights to do so without my approval, proper written approval. So I said, no, I do not approve the publication and forget about it. So I received a letter from the editor and talking and said, yeah, we did cheat, yeah. So, but you know, if we did not, then the censors would never approve it. So we cut these pieces before they sent it to center. So I said, but forget about the publication, this is my reputation. So then we start negotiating. So I sent them a long list of pieces that I demand to be restored in the book. So without these pieces, I will not approve. So we negotiated, they accepted 90%. So the most heated debate was about the last phrase in the book. The last phrase is, I wrote that the great dictator, tyrant, and the revolutionary died at the age of 83. Okay. In the proofs, I read, the great revolutionary died. I said, no way. So we began to look for a good word. Okay. So they didn't accept tyrant. They didn't accept dictator. But finally, we agreed on cruel, iron-handed ruler. So anyway, but I'm happy that they actually restore the most important pieces. So I'm not ashamed of this book. I'm very happy that they published the book. First, because that's the first book, and I know for sure now, that's the first book published in the People's Republic of China that is the most critical about Mao Zedong. And it's not my words, but Professor Liu also read it on the internet. Two of my translators, they published a long letter on the internet comparing my Taiwanese, American, and Chinese edition. They were also upset with all these cuts made by the censors. And they said that overall, we're still very satisfied with the publication because it's the most critical biography of Mao ever published in the People's Republic of China. That's what I really want, you see, to convey this truth. But it doesn't matter if they did not use the word tyrant. But if you read the book, you will see that he was a tyrant, you see, because they preserve all the documents, you see. And then I'm happy because it's the only book that had all the documents and all the materials that we had to cut from Russian and American editions. It's the biggest edition, you see. So you cannot find these documents and you cannot find many things in the Taiwanese edition. The Taiwanese edition, of course, is straightforward. If Mao is bad, Mao is bad, you see. But here, you understand. But anyway, there are many, many documents, interesting documents, you see. So, ironically, all these biographies of Mao, they're quite different, you see. But they have the same straightforward idea. Mao was not saint, not a demon, but it's a mixture, you see. And we must be objective and to acknowledge what he did and, you know, to say what crimes he committed. So, anyway, this is two volumes. They published two volumes. My Mao Zedong Zhuang in People's University Press. So, this is Deng Xiaoping book published in the United States with Oxford University Press. It came out this year also in May. Okay, important for me. As I already said to you, what I tried to do, I tried to write, first, of course, lovely, biography is for general public, but it's, of course, meticulously documented, okay? But I wrote for general public, okay? So I tried to write a nice read, but also I believe that both books, Mao and Deng, are objective. So I tried to show that what crimes they did, I tried to show what good things they did, and so on. So again, it's not political pamphlets, but it's a, scholarly research. I show you some documents from the Russian archives, maybe it will be interested, and then by the end of the lecture I will sum up what I did in this book. So, I discovered that Jane, Mao Zedong's third wife, when she broke with Mao, she was pregnant. And she came to Russia and gave birth to a kid. So this is the birth certificate, the original birth certificate, okay? The last unknown son of Mao Zedong was born in the Soviet Union. In 9 months, this baby died, okay? Had tremendous impact on her mentality. Maybe many of you know that Jane finally lost her mind and was hospitalized in a psychoclinic. These are some documents from Mao Zedong personal archives. Every member of the Comintern, and Mao Zedong was also a member of the Comintern, they had to fill out a special questionnaire, okay, to answer questions. Mao didn't travel to Moscow until 1949, but his younger brother, Mao Zemin, traveled to Moscow, and this is Mao Zemin handwriting. He filled out this form on behalf of Mao Zedong, okay? I already published this, okay? So, okay, so this is a biography of Mao written by Jane. She was also in Moscow, as I said, and the Comintern people asked her to write biography of Mao, and she wrote biography of Mao. So you see her signature, yeah, Jane, and in parentheses, Wen Yun, that's your name. Under this name, she lived in Russia. Okay. So this is an original Mao Zedong letter to Fan Lin. It's then Fa. So to the Comintern, this is his handwriting. You see, it's not so important letter, but anyway, this is. There are lots of handwritten letters by Mao Zedong and others. So. This is ciphered telegrams. There is a special section of the archives correspondence between Mao Zedong and Stalin. And Stalin signed his letters with the name Filipov, okay, that's a code name. So ciphered telegrams is one of the most interesting sections of the archives. Okay, they exchange views and stuff like this. So, by the way, from one of these telegrams, I learned, maybe it will be interesting for you to know, that Mao Zedong consulted with Stalin on every single thing. Actually, to be precise, on most things, you see. And, for example, in 1949, Mao even sent a ciphered telegram to Stalin asking him, "What do you think, Comrade Stalin, where should we set up a capital of the People's Republic of China, in Beijing or in Nanjing?" And Stalin answered, "Beijing." Okay, maybe it will be interesting to keep in mind to see, how Stalin could actually influence Mao. So there are many other telegrams between Stalin, Mao, and Stalin's representatives to Mao and stuff like this. Mao's little telegram to Stalin, you see. So, there are many documents concerning financial issues, financial problems. So, What I got from the archives, the first idea I tried to convey, you know, in all my books. We will never understand the history of the Chinese Communist movement if we miss the fact that the Chinese Communist Party had been under tough control of the Russian Bolshevik Party. So it was under the Bolshevik Party, not only in the 20s. The conventional view, I mean, that most American scholars, Western scholars share that, yeah, the Comintern helped the Chinese Communist Party in the 1920s, set up the Chinese Communist Party, financed and so on. But then Mao Zedong came to power, and Mao Zedong was rather nationalist than communist, and Mao Zedong distanced himself from the Soviet Union, and you know, here we are, finally we have the rift, the Sino-Soviet rift and so on. When I came to the archives and began to work with the documents, I had the same views. I want to remind you that many, many years ago, 55 years ago, in 1960, in the first issue of the most famous journal on China, China Quarterly, a great scholar whose name was Carl August Wittfogel published an article titled A Legend of Maoism. In the second issue, the great American sinologist whose name was Benjamin Schwartz published his own article, A Legend of Maoism. So against Wittfogel. The Fogel idea was that there is no difference between Mao and Stalin. Benjamin Schwartz said, no, there is difference, and Mao is a national Chinese communist, but not, you know, different from Stalin, stuff like this. It was in 1960, and of course the Sino-Soviet rift, okay, supported basically Benjamin Schwartz's view. Okay, and this is the conventional view. So, liberal American school that claimed that Mao was different, stuff like this. When I came to the archives and began to work with the documents, I understood that Wittfogel was right. Actually, what I found that indeed Mao never distanced himself from Stalin until Stalin's death. You see, he had considered himself a true disciple of Stalin, and he emancipated himself only in 1956 when Khrushchev denounced Stalin at the 20th Congress. Then he began to realize, and his first reaction to Khrushchev's report on the cult of personality and the consequence was positive, not negative. He welcomed the denunciation of Stalin, and we have stenographic. We have members of many people who attended meetings of the Political Bureau and Secretariat when they discussed the report and stuff like this. Mao felt emancipated, you see, finally. He would oppose the denunciation of Stalin only after the Polish and Hungarian events at the end of, you know, October 1956. You know what I'm talking about, when the Poles and Hungarians revolted against the Soviets, and you know, and Mao began to think, oh my God, what Khrushchev did. Not before. So, all documents prove it, and their correspondence, okay? And I found incredibly interesting documents about the origin of new democracy. Maybe it will be interesting for you. So, still, today, most people believe that it was Mao's theory. It was not Mao's theory. Mao got this idea from Stalin. In 1937, you know that Mao came with his theory of new democracy officially at the end of 1939 in his publication, his article, The Chinese Revolution, the Chinese Communist Party, and then he developed it next year in his famous book, Siming Zhu Zhu Ilun, on New Democracy. But 2 years prior to the publication of this book, Stalin gave this idea to Wang Min. Wang Min was head of the Chinese Communist Party delegation to the Executive Committee of the Comintern. And Wang Min was about to go to China because his tenure was over, okay? He was replaced by Wang Zesan. So Wang Min and Kan Shen were about to go to Russia, and they met with Stalin in the Kremlin. And Stalin said to them, basically, that tell Mao that you should abandon the ideas of the socialist revolution. We should change it, okay? No struggle for the socialist revolution anymore. And he gave them this idea. So I found these documents, then I just carefully read Mao Zedong, and I discovered the evolution of his ideas, okay? When he was interviewed by many foreigners in 1937, he still talked that the future revolution would be socialist. But then he began to talk about the nationalist revolution and democratic revolution, stuff like this. Okay, so I found many, many financial receipts. Okay, this is a letter written by T.C. Lee. T.C. Lee is Li Dajiao. Okay, so I am sure you already read it, okay? So Li Dajiao asked money. Dear comrade, this is the Soviet ambassador to China, Karakhan. This is a letter by Chen Duxiu, okay? The same story. We already started the anti-imperialist work according to your instructions. Who gave instructions? The Russians, okay? But we never received the necessary fund that you promised to pay. Who paid money? The Russians. This is the 1920s, this is Li Dajiao again, okay? This is also Li Dajiao, okay? This is Deng Xiaoping file, okay, that's how it looks like, okay? He lived in Russia under the name Ivan Sergeyevich Dozorov. This is Russian name, okay? This is also Deng Xiaoping file. This is the characteristic of Deng Xiaoping, okay, very good characteristic. This is a file of Zhang Siyuan, his wife. Okay, this is the file of his second wife, Di Weiying. Okay, many, many other documents. So, many people who ever studied the history of the Chinese Communist Party, they believe that Stalin had his own man in the leadership of the Chinese Communist Party, and they always emphasize that was Wang Min. They even talk about the so-called faction of the 28 and they have Bolsheviks, probably heard about it, the Comintern faction, internationalist faction, and stuff like this, okay? This is not correct. What I discovered while working in the Russian archives, we never took into account the problem with the Comintern. In the Comintern, in the leadership of the Comintern, and in the leadership of the Bolshevik party, there are many factions, many groups. And these people, they hated each other. You see, Stalin was above the faction, okay, like Machiavellian, you know, concept of power. But within the leadership, we have different factions, you see. And each faction in the Comintern, they promoted their own people to the leadership of the Chinese Communist Party. You see what I mean? So Wang Min was not a man of Stalin. Wang Min was a man of the, one of the leaders of the Eastern Department of the Chinese Communist, of the Comintern, whose name was Pavel Mif. Okay? So, He used to be his student, and they had very close relations. And Pavel Mif promoted Wang Min, you see, not Stalin. Another group in the Comintern promoted another people, you know, another group of Chinese leaders, including Zhou Enlai, Xiang Yi, okay, and Zhang Guotao, you see, to the leadership, you see. They opposed Wang Min, you see. So Stalin began to promote Mao in 1930, okay, to counterweight, you see, these two groups, you see. So he began to promote a guerrilla leader, you see what I mean. But for some time, he did not, you know, make the final decision. We have three different groups in the early 30s. One main group, Zhou Enlai, Zhang Gaotao group, and Mao Zedong group. You see what I mean? So if we understand that we have different factions, intra-communist struggle, then we'll understand many things. But later, Mif was arrested by KGB and executed as an enemy of the people. Stalin lost confidence in 1 minute. You see what I mean? Lost confidence. And when you check correspondence between Dimitrov, who was the head of the Comintern in the 1930s, 40s, it was Dimitrov who corresponded to Mao Zedong and the Central Committee of the Chinese Communist Party, but Dimitrov was not independent. Dimitrov transmitted what Stalin said to him, you see. So basically, it was Stalin who corresponded to Mao Zedong through the mouth of Dimitrov, you see. And you would see that Stalin, through the mouth of Dimitrov, in spite of the fact that Dimitrov was a close friend of Wan Min, you see, and Wan Min's daughter was adopted by Dimitrov and lived in Dimitrov's family, you see. But still, he had to say to Mao Zedong that Wan Min is not reliable, it's not good, you see. Then I found documents that Stalin even planned to help Mao when he finally decided Mao would be the leader. He even developed an idea to convene the special trial on the Comintern leaders. You know, we had three show trials in Russia, okay? On Zinoviev Kamenev, Radek Pyatakov, and Bukharin Andreyev. Stalin planned the fourth trial on the Comintern. Okay, activists. And I found minutes of interrogation. Sometimes when you read documents, you see, I found many minutes of interrogation, then Chinese and Comintern activists were arrested, they tortured, and sometimes you see spots, okay, red spots, okay, on this document. So, so I found out that one of the members of the Comintern, he gave these names, but the interrogator demanded him to sign the accusation against this man. You see what I mean? So Stalin planned a show trial, okay, and he collected negative information, so basically most top leaders of the Chinese Communist Party. You see what I mean? But not about Mao. Please, you see, there is no name of Mao here. There is Chu Chubai, who was already dead at that time. You see, but still he collected, information on these people. You see? So, I don't know what happened in Stalin's mind. We never had this trial, you see. But Stalin could arrest these people. He could. He arrested Lili Sein, everybody knows, you see what I mean. And Lili Sein spent 16 years in Russia, you see, and was arrested, tortured, beaten, and stuff like this. He arrested Chen Yui, not Chen Yun, but Chen Yui, another top party leader. Many, many other people were arrested, tortured, Chinese Trotskys were arrested, many of them shot to death and stuff like this. So, then, in late 1939, early 1940, I found a document from the Executive Committee of the Comintern. They prepared recommendation for Mao Zedong for the future 7th Congress of the Chinese Communist Party. So the whole list of people who Mao was supposed to elect to the member of the Central Committee. Personal decisions were made in Moscow. You see what I mean? So many, many interesting, what else I found out? In the 1920s, early 1930s, the Central Committee of the Chinese Communist Party fabricated, made all documents, at least all major documents, in three copies. One copy would go to the archives, to the Central Committee. The third copy would be used to make, they used it as a, you know, the copy to make, to run copies for the local organizations, and the third copy would go to Moscow. So if we do not have an access to the Chinese Communist Party archives in Beijing, go to Moscow. You can find all documents there, you see. So, Stalin supported the rectification campaign in Yan'an that Mao Zedong initiated. Okay, never opposed this. I already mentioned about new democracy. I found many interesting documents about Stalin and Mao Zedong relations during the Korean War. That Stalin actually planned the whole operation. If you have questions, I will answer this question about the Korean War. Unfortunately, we are running out of time. So I found many interesting documents in the archives about the Cultural Revolution, dispatches of the Soviet spies in China and diplomats that prove that indeed Mao Zedong started the Cultural Revolution not because it was a struggle for power. Everybody worshipped Mao. He had no real opposition in the Central Committee of the Chinese Communist Party. Indeed, it was his utopian goal to create an ideal person, an ideal society. What I found about Deng Xiaoping, major things. Okay, if you have any questions about Deng Xiaoping, I would develop it. So the most important. When I began to write about Deng Xiaoping, again, I had to oppose the conventional view. The conventional view is that Deng Xiaoping represented a moderate faction within the Chinese Communist Party and periodically opposed Mao, and everybody knows his cats. Yeah. For some reasons, people talk about white and black, but Deng Xiaoping said yellow. Okay. And black, but anyway, it doesn't matter. But everybody knows his reaction to the Great Leap Forward in the early 60s and how he supported the division of land in the 1860s, and then how he promoted economic reforms and modernization in the 1973-75 when he got back to power and so on. No. What I found proves that until the death of Mao Zedong, Deng Xiaoping had been a true disciple of Mao, had been extremely loyal to Mao. He came up with the famous cats, not because he really tried to oppose Mao, but because Mao, when he came to power in 1949 and on, Mao Zedong began to behave as an emperor, or kind of like a Confucius Taoist philosopher, okay? You know, he spent all days in his bedroom, huge, enormous bed, okay? Half of the bed was covered with books, okay? He received members of the political bureau in his bedroom, you see. He was half naked, you know, eating, and all these people would sit around and listen, you see what I mean? Deng had hearing problems, so he would close to the pillow, you see, listening. And Mao would start talking like a Chinese, a Confucianist Taoist philosopher. It was very hard to understand what he wants, you see. They would say, what should we do? And Mao would say, what can we do? Rain would continue to fall down, widows would remarry, blah, blah, blah. You see what I mean? And then people would start thinking, what did he want to say? You see, in the wake of the Great Leap Forward, the beginning of the Great Famine, Mao, was criticized, at the famous meeting of 7,000 country, and he was offended and sent to Pen Zheng, to Liu Shaoqi, Chen Yun, and other people. You know what to do, okay, do it. And he retired to Hangzhou, you see, for several months. So he didn't say what to do, you see what I mean? And these people, they began to think, in the same day when he left Beijing, they began to think what to do. Liu Shaoqi convened the meeting. And they didn't know what to do, you see? And Chen Yun said, look at Anhui province, you know, they began to divide land. Maybe it's a good idea. Everybody agreed. You see what I mean? Everybody agreed. Then Deng Xiaoping coined this phrase, it doesn't matter what color of the cat and stuff like this, because, you know, we can divide land, nothing bad to socialism here, you see what I mean? Why did he say so? He didn't know that Mao was against it. When Mao Zedong got it, he said, ah, here we are. You are very bad, you are capitalist road and stuff like this. When Khrushchev denounced Stalin, Mao became very suspicious. He began to suspect everyone around him. Who would be the next Khrushchev? The whole idea of the Cultural Revolution, look at the documents. The whole idea, May 16th, the major paragraph. Who is China's Khrushchev? You see what I mean? Who would denounce me when I'm there? And he was very, very skeptical. In particular, you know his famous phrase, let snakes go out of the holes, you see, and we catch them, you see. That's what he tried to do. He tried to provoke them. And then he got news about these cats and stuff like this. He got back to Beijing and attacked these people. The first was Liu Shaoqi, who visited him at the swimming pool. Mao was swimming. Liu Shaoqi came. He attacked him. Then Chen Yun immediately wrote to Deng Xiaoping, said, I'm sick. And he would be sick until the death of Mao Zedong. You see what I mean? So he would never get back because everybody scared. Deng Xiaoping immediately called Hu Yaoban, who was the first secretary of the communist youth, because he coined this phrase about the CAS, the Congress of the Communist Youth. Okay, Hu Yaoban was the first secretary. And they had the stenographic record. He called Hu Yaoban and said, delete the cats from the stenographic record. You see? Hu Yaoban deleted, but everybody remembered. You see what I mean? Liu Shaoqi immediately said, no division of land. It's bad. It's very bad. It's very bad. But Mao could not stop, you see? And then many times, you know, Mao was sick. They had a meeting. And Deng Xiaoping called Mao Zedong, and he was the general secretary. He called Mao Zedong and said, Comrade Mao, if you sick, don't go to the meeting. I mean, it's just a routine question. Why did he call Mao? Because he liked Mao Zedong. Mao Zedong was sick. But then Mao Zedong got an idea. Ah, you don't want me to come. And he came to the meeting with the Constitution of the People's Republic of China and with chart of the Chinese Communist Party and said, this Constitution gives me rights to speak. And this chart of the Communist Party gives me the right to speak as a Communist Party. But this man, Deng Xiaoping, he called me and said, don't go to the meeting. It's ridiculous. Deng said, what's going on? I'm innocent. But you cannot say to Mao that I'm innocent. Lin Biao tried to say I'm innocent. You see what happened? He's dead. You see what I mean? What Mao really wanted from Lin Biao? From Lin Biao, the same like from Deng Xiaoping. Come to me and say, I'm wrong. You see? Zhou Enlai came to Lin Biao and said, you know, he's an old man. Go to Mao Zedong and say, sorry, I made mistakes. But Lin Biao was sick. You see, I found in his volumes what the disease he had. You see, why he was so sick. He had a wound during the war, okay? And it hit his nerves and the spine. He had terrible pain. That's why he always took morphine, you know, drugs. So, and Lin Biao said no, but then Xiaoping said yes, sorry. You know how many letters and how many confessions he made during the Cultural Revolution? He acknowledged all his crime, all his mistakes, alleged mistakes. He didn't commit any mistakes. His son broke his neck, you see, and he still said sorry, Mao, you're great, you see. In 1973, he started modernization. Why? Because Mao wanted. Mao wanted, and Mao said to him, we need modernization. Only in 1976, he started reforms. Okay. Then what else I found about Deng Xiaoping, that was he's incredibly cruel, incredibly tyrannical. In 1950, during the land reform, okay, in the area under Deng Xiaoping control, every day, 46 average, okay, 46 so-called counter-revolutionaries were shot to death. If you speak about the whole China, it was 10, 12, you see. Even Mao Zedong was shocked and wrote a letter to Deng Xiaoping and said, you don't need to kill so many people. Then Deng Xiaoping immediately answered, of course not. And they immediately reduced the number to 10, 12 people, you see. So, of course, everybody knows about Tiananmen Massacre and so on. Just recently, I received an offer from the same publishing house and another publishing house, Zhenmin Chumanshi, People's Publishing House, also sent me an offer to translate and publish my Deng Xiaoping book in China. I said, no, it's impossible. It's impossible. We can publish the book about Mao Zedong, but we cannot publish the book about Deng Xiaoping in China because you understand. But the book is coming out in Taiwan. Next April, the same publishing house, they're translating the book, so it will come out in Chinese, the whole book, in Taiwan, April 2015. So thank you so much. My students, they know that if I start talking, it's very difficult to stop me. So I'm sorry that you know I spent so much time, but we still have 20 minutes for your questions, please.
Thank you so much for the wonderful talk. I have two questions. You mentioned the connection between Chairman Mao Zedong and Stalin. How independent do you think Mao is? When Stalin was still alive, how independent Mao when
yeah, he I understand.
Yeah,
that's the first question. The second question,
I'm curious about whether you have encountered any document about Lin Biao's incident, because there are many people in China that are still like, this is a myth in China, say how Lin Biao's airplane was.
I understand.
Thank you.
About this Wu Qiyi, yeah, 571, this affair, yeah, right. The crash. Yeah, okay, the first question. Yeah, of course, it's one of the major topics in my book, the relationship between Stalin and Mao Zedong. So, Mao considered Stalin the great Marxist and the great theoretician. Until the denunciation of Stalin in 1956, Mao Zedong was absolutely sure that if we start building socialism in China, we're supposed to follow the Russian way. There is no any other way. Okay, there is only one experience. Stalin published a famous book, The Economic Problems of Socialism. So that was the book, you know, and the short course, you know, famous book that was immediately translated in Yan'an. And Mao read it, okay, and Mao considered himself Stalinist, okay, and he was Stalinist, Chinese Stalinist, but he was Stalinist. And Mao dominated his consciousness, Stalin's concepts, Stalin's vision of socialism dominated Mao consciousness, you see. So, great desire of Stalin, we know from documents, of Mao, he wanted to see Stalin, he wanted to meet Stalin. And during the Civil War, 1946-49, he sent several messages to Stalin, asking Stalin's permission to visit Stalin in Moscow. Stalin always said no. Why did Stalin say no? Because Stalin wanted to distance Mao from Russia to create an illusion in the world that Mao was independent, nationalist, and even liberal new democracy, you see what I mean, and had no connections to Russia. Why did he do so? To keep America off China, you see what I mean? So he was absolutely convinced that this policy of new democracy would help Mao seize power that Stalin really wanted. That was not only policy of the Chinese Communist Party. Stalin changed the whole policy, the policy of the whole world communist movement. Vietnam, East Europe, every country, they abandoned communism, okay, formally. And all of them pretended to be liberal. Democratic Republic of Vietnam, you see what I mean? Ho Chi Minh pronounced the Democratic Republic of Vietnam, the August Revolution. When he read the Declaration of Independence, he plagiarized from Jefferson, you know what I mean? You can check it. He plagiarized from Jefferson, you see. And the American, OSS people who were in Hanoi, they said, he's a great guy. He's liberal. The two American ambassadors from China and from Russia, ambassadors to Russia and China, they visited Molotov, who was, in Russia, foreign minister, during the war. And they said, we're curious, who is Mao Zedong? Who are the Chinese communists? And Molotov said, who are you talking about? I don't know them. It's just a bunch of nationalists. Next day, Harriman, and Patrick Hurley, the ambassadors, visited Stalin. Molotov was there, and they said to Stalin, look, Comrade Molotov yesterday said you have never had any relations to the Chinese Communist Party. Stalin said, who are you talking about? I don't know these people. This is liberal. You see what I mean? Then, that's why he said to Mao, don't go, otherwise, people would say that, you're my satellite. You see what I mean? He didn't say this, but, he assumed this. The Russian press at that time never called Mao Zedong comrade. They called him Mr. You know the difference, yeah? So it's a bourgeois, man. And so on. So he received Mao only after the great victory of the Chinese Revolution in December 1949. You see, yes?
On that point, when Mao arrived in Moscow in December, he was also referred to as Mr. in the Soviet press after having come to power.
Yeah.
And how do you explain that?
No, but that was, he was referred Mr., but then, if you know, when they signed the treaty.
Yeah, but before they signed it in December, it was Mr.
But if you check in February 1950, when they signed the treaty, he was already comrade, you see. But, at first, Mr., but he received him in December, you see. And he was in the Bolshoi Theater, next to Stalin, and he, delivered the speech and stuff like this. I have a special chapter about it in the book, negotiations and, quite interesting. Because I found very interesting documents, documents from Mao's physicians, Mao was terribly upset during this visit, because Stalin treated him badly, But Stalin treated him badly to show him that I'm the boss and you're nothing, you see. He didn't receive him for a long time, and so on. I even found a document that when Stalin finally began to receive Mao, it was when the United Kingdom recognized the People's Republic of China. When Mao felt during the conversation, Stalin teased him all the time, you see. And he would say to Mao, I know that you guys, you are nationalists, not communists. You follow the Tito way, Joseph Broz Tito, you will be nationalist, stuff like this. And all the time, black humor, you see, black humor. And so Mao, there's something wrong with his heart. And he said, I need to go to bed. It wasn't Stalin's dacha. And Stalin led him to his bedroom and even gave him a pillow. You see what I mean? He felt terribly ill. Okay, this is about relations with Stalin. The second question was?
Lin Biao.
Yeah, there are documents about Lin Biao affair. The reports from the Mongols. You see, because it was in Mongolia, you see, and the Mongols received the Russian delegation. You know that the Russians cut Lin Biao's head. I mean from the dead body, you see, because Lin Biao used to live in Moscow. He was the last representative of the Chinese Communist Party to the Comintern. And he had teeth problem, okay? So dentists, okay, they check his teeth and, you know, okay, so they had his medical folder, how you call it, yeah? And so they cut his head to check if it was Lin Biao or not, okay? So the head is still there somewhere in the KGB archives, I mean the skull probably, you know, but I never had an access to the KGB archives. But I had access to some reports, the Mongol reports, okay, and the Russian reports about what they found. In four volumes of Lin Biao, there are many, many interesting documents about, as I said to you, about his disease. Okay, and when I wrote my Mao, I met with Lin Biao's daughter, Dou Dou, in China. And she wasn't particularly interested in these documents. And we talk a lot about this strange disease that is mental disease, you see, Lin Biao had. Okay, he was very interested in these files, and I copied these files, gave it to her, and stuff like this. So, the most interesting documents about the Lin Biao affair, they're in KGB archives, and we still don't have access to them, you see. But only these two reports, they give a picture, you know, what actually happened. You see, then I interviewed Dou Dou a lot about it, so you know that Dou Dou actually betrayed her father. You know, she informed the Chinese, you know, guard that her mother tried to kidnap the father and so on. But it's a long story. You can simply read the book, so I published. Yeah, you have a question.
So, I also have two questions, sir. The first one is about Jiang Zemin. Mm-hmm. When he was at studying at Soviet Union, there were rumors floating that he was recruited by KGB or like he was being like that. Are these true? And second, second question is that are there any Soviet archives or about the fact of Zhao Ziyang, Wilbang, and their policies and their conflict with the Xiaoping?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I understand. So the first question about Jiang Zemin, but he lived in the Soviet Union in the 50s, as far as I remember. So and I did not work with the documents about Jiang Zemin. And I'm pretty sure, first, I don't think that he was recruited. But second, if they have any documents about Jiang Zemin and the KGB, they must be in the KGB archives. But not in any other archives, you see. And the KGB archives, as I already said, this is these archives are not Bushukaifan. You see, they're not open. You see what I mean? So, what about Zhao Ziyan and Deng Xiaoping? I didn't get you.
So I'm just really curious about the conflicts between Huelbang and
Zhao Ziyan, you said?
Yeah, both Huelbang and Zhao Ziyan to Deng Xiaoping. Like, in the issues that, for example, let's just talk about Zhao Ziyan. Like,
okay.
In his, like, he constantly made decision of not suppress of the student movement.
Yeah. And, I understand.
And then they're like,
yeah.
And he also made the commitment that he also said something like that the Deng was still in huge influence of the party,
mm-hmm.
and then Deng used that as a reason.
Yeah. I understand you. Yeah.
So can I just review a more information mm-hmm. about the conflict between them?
Thank you. Yeah, I understand what you're talking about. Yeah. Of course, I wrote a lot about it in the book. And my colleague and good friend Ezra Vogel also wrote about a lot about it in his huge book that is not a biography of Deng Xiaoping, but it's a biography of Deng Xiaoping's reform, you see. So it's an excellent book, but it covers just one third of Deng Xiaoping's life. And of course they had contradictions. And it's pretty well known that Zhao Ziyan opposed Deng Xiaoping in regard to the students, you see, and he came to the students in Tiananmen Square and said, please forgive us, you see. And actually, we have documents that prove that it was Deng Xiaoping who gave an ultimate order to clean the square. He said it, okay. He was not the most radical extremist among the members of the this tiny group, okay. It was the group of elders. Wang Zheng was the most, okay. Wang Zheng and Yang Shangkun, you see. But they discussed it, and practically everybody agreed. But then Deng Xiaoping articulated this. You know, he said that we need to clean. You know that the relationship between Zhao Ziyan and Hu Yaoban on one side and Deng Xiaoping on the other side. Zhao Ziyan and Hu Yaoban de facto, okay, served as Deng Xiaoping's secretaries. You see what I mean? And Deng Xiaoping, then when he was already old, he did not attend meetings of the political bureau, you see. He sent his technical secretary to attend these meetings. Zhao Ziyan and Hu Yaoban reported to Deng Xiaoping, but they had to go to his house. He received them in his house, you see. And you know that Deng Xiaoping, you can read the great book by Zhao Ziyan, of course, you know his memoirs. He remembers that Deng Xiaoping's role in the party at the end was, they joked about it. They said that Deng Xiaoping plays a role of the mother-in-law, you see, in a big family, you see. So he is, he rules from behind the screens, you see. Mother-in-law, that's how they call him, you see. And when Deng Xiaoping resigned, Zhao Ziyan delivered a great speech saying that Deng Xiaoping was so great, wonderful, and great Marxist-Leninist and stuff like this. So Deng Xiaoping, when Hu Yaoban got a heart attack and was at the hospital, Deng Xiaoping didn't want to visit him, okay? We have Yang Shangkun memoirs, okay? And Yang Shangkun remembers that when people approached Deng Xiaoping and said it would be good if you visit him at the hospital, Deng Xiaoping answered, I'm not a doctor. You see, why should I go there? He didn't want to attend his funeral, Hu Yaoban funeral, but he attended the funeral because Zhou Lin asked him to do so. It was Zhou Lin's request. You see, you know that Zhou Lin and Hu Yaoban used to be very close. And actually, Deng Xiaoping began to promote Hu Yaoban because, thanks to Zhou Lin, you know, because they were very close in the youth. You know, it's Zhou Lin gave the name to Deng Xiaoping, Hu Yaoban. So, yeah, any more questions? Yes, please. Yeah,
I noticed you mentioned in the PowerPoint that the personal conflict between Khrushchev and Mao actually contributed to the final split.
Yes, absolutely.
What extent do you think? Does it to a big extent, or if it's not Khrushchev says Molotov, will there be a split or not?
I understand. Very good question, and sorry, but you know that Professor Liu asked me to talk about three major topics: the archives, Mao book, and Deng Xiaoping book, and the fourth topic myself. So you see that I couldn't cover everything.
Yeah.
It's a great question. I will answer in 2 minutes, okay? And then your question, okay? Just wait a second. Very interesting. I wrote a lot about it in Deng Xiaoping's book. In Mao Zedong book also. Yeah, the personal enmity, okay? You can check internet, for example. Feng Huan, I gave them an interview just recently. You can find on Chinese internet, and they had the same question. Because our friend Shen Zhihua, he will come here Monday. He has an idea that the major problem that caused the rift was that Mao tried to establish his ascendancy over the World Communist Movement, so that was the struggle between two powers and stuff like this. Yeah, it was important. But in this interview, I said, just imagine if Stalin lived longer. Mao would have never opposed Stalin. Never. You see that many people believe that Mao began to quarrel with Khrushchev at the end of the 50s, and you know, his famous talks, and Mao, you know, Mao was a smoker. And in 1958, when Khrushchev visited, you know, Mao, he began to smoke straight to Khrushchev's face. Khrushchev hated smoke, you see. Then Mao asked Khrushchev to go to the swimming pool. It's a famous swimming pool talks. Mao was a brilliant swimmer. Khrushchev was like this. So, you know, that was humiliation. You see what I mean? Yeah. And in 1957, when Mao visited Moscow, he attacked Khrushchev verbally. You see what you know. We can tell you lots of stories about it. But it was not the beginning. The beginning was in 1954, when Khrushchev visited China, the fifth anniversary of the revolution. Khrushchev, read carefully Khrushchev's memoirs, okay? Incredible read. Three volumes in English, four volumes in Russian. Khrushchev was like a little baby, you see. He had a dream to see the world, but Stalin never let him go, you see. When he seized power, he began to travel like crazy, you see. He ruled Russia for 10 years, roughly 5 years he spent outside Russia, you see. So, and he came to China for 2 weeks, you see. And just traveling, you see, and he was so excited. On the way to China, he joked with his people, you know, we will eat snake, blah, blah, blah. You see what I mean? He was incredible. And when he came to China, he was so excited, he couldn't control himself. He made the first mistake in the airport. He came out of the plane, you know what he did? He came to Mao and kissed him in public in China. To kiss in public in 1954. You know, man and wife couldn't kiss each other, you know, in the street, you see. So, but he didn't notice. He kissed everybody, you see. Then during the negotiations, okay, he acted like a merchant, like a trader, you know, I'm so rich, you know, I can give you everything. And Mao and Zhou began to bombard him with requests. So how about if you give us this? How about if you give us this? How about this? How about this? And Khrushchev would say, yeah, why not? Oh, yeah, yeah. And finally, we know from Jiang Xin memoirs that Mao, every time he got back home, he had only one word from Khrushchev, Heng Chun. You know, idiot, stupid. You see what I mean? So he made the major mistake, Khrushchev. That was the first summit. Khrushchev should not come to China. Khrushchev must wait in Moscow until Mao arrived in Moscow. You see the difference? I mean, he was supposed to act like the leader, you know, but he acted like a guest. You see, he came to Mao and Mao was the host, you see? Immediately Mao understood everything. And Khrushchev gave lots of gifts, but Mao had only one word, Heng Chun. I mean, he took it as weakness, you see. Stalin was strong, Khrushchev was weak, you see. That's why all these negotiations about nuclear bomb and stuff like this and stuff like this. And then it was like a snowball. Mao couldn't control himself. Every time he saw Khrushchev, he teased him, and stuff like this. You know what he did? Stalin image, it's also an answer to your question. Image of Stalin had dominated Mao consciousness until Mao's death. You see, his whole life was like a reaction to Stalin. You know, Stalin humiliated him greatly. You know, in Russia in 1949-50, Mao Diulian, you know, Mao lost his face. You know how sensitive for Chinese, you see? He lost his, you know what I mean? So, and his next reaction, you know, to the Chinese leadership, to the Russian leadership, in 1957, he arrived in Moscow for the second time. He treated Khrushchev as if Mao were Stalin, you see what I mean? He did absolutely the same. It was the same black humor, you see? The same. It was just the Chinese Stalin to Khrushchev. You know this story when in 1957 Mao Zedong began to talk at the meeting of the International Communist Parties. He began to talk about nuclear war. That, oh, it's not a problem, a nuclear war, so what? A half of the population would die. It's okay, but a half of the population survived and socialism will win, okay? And people look around and say, what he's talking about? If you open many books about it, people speculate, why did he do so? He wanted to provoke a conflict between the United States and Russia and stuff like this. Nothing. It was a black humor, you see. When a leader of the Italian Communist Party asked the question, Comrade Mao Zedong, you said that a half of the population would survive, most of them were Chinese, so socialists were, you know, Chinese, the most populous. How many Italians will survive? And Mao looked at him and said, no one. But why do you think that Italians are so important for the humankind? You see, it was black humor, exactly like Stalin. You see what I mean? So, of course, it was how he attacked. We have stenographic records, you see. How, and finally, Khrushchev actually didn't understand at first. He believed, I'm good. But Mao teased him. And finally, Khrushchev said, my God, what's going on? And he counterattacked. You know, and in many places, he began to talk about Mao as a stupid guy, about the great reform and stuff. Khrushchev was an alcoholic, by the way. You know, and when he, in particular, when he was drunk, and he was drunk all the time, so he would curse Mao and didn't think about anything. You see what I mean? And Mao got this, and then